presents this unabridged recording of Mental, everything you never knew you needed to know about mental health. Written and read by Steve Ellen
and Catherine Deveny. Perhaps we should begin by introducing ourselves.
I'm Steve, a psychiatrist who's been working as a clinician for the past 28 years. I've worked mainly in general hospitals, helping people with medical and surgical problems. This includes pretty much everything: overdoses, depression, anxiety, eating disorders, schizophrenia, coping with illnesses and trauma, including cancer, HIV/AIDS and transplants, and anything else that might bring a person to a hospital. I also do a little research and teaching, and am a professor at the University of Melbourne. About 15 years ago, I developed an interest in health communication, and since then have worked in radio, print and TV. I also suffered depression for about a year, and this helped inspire the writing of this book.
And I'm Dev, a writer, comedian, social commentator and public speaker. I've experienced lots of mental health problems and treatments and developed a strong sense of what does and doesn't work for me. I'm grateful for the help I've received, but also concerned that getting the right help is not as easy as many people think. Also, I believe the things you do for yourself and the help you get from the people you love are probably more important than all the drugs and therapy in the world. Figuring out the right formula is the real challenge. We're both really passionate about mental health. We know what it's like to suffer from mental health issues and how hard it is to find good, clear advice. So we wanted to put everything you need to know into one book. We were keen to make it a cracking read, but also a valuable reference. Mental is for people living with a mental illness, people with loved ones who might have a mental illness, and the curious amateur shrinks. It's also a guide for people who come into contact with the mentally ill but feel underprepared: lawyers, the media, teachers, carers, whoever. We hope to increase understanding, reduce stigma, and provide an accessible and readable book that covers the length and breadth of the field. Our aim is to explain mental illness in a way that is easy to understand for the intelligent layperson. No prior knowledge is required. We've tried to give both a bird's eye view and a peek under the bonnet. We've included the latest medical information, but we've also provided reflections on the cultural and political context of mental health care.
By reading Mental, we hope you'll learn about mental health, you'll think about yourself and others, you'll know what to do if life goes wrong, and you'll be inspired to seek out more information. We want this to be the beginning of a conversation, not the end. We've researched the information well, but not exhaustively. And we've tried to give you quality perspectives and opinion in a field where disagreement and dissent is the norm, without boring you senseless with endless debate. More than anything, Mental is not a replacement for face-to-face help. You cannot treat yourself just with this book, but it will give you the latest knowledge and understanding in a field that is endlessly fascinating and constantly evolving. We hope you enjoy reading Mental as much as we enjoyed writing it.
Part 1, The Big Picture. Chapter 1, What is Mental Illness? How do we define mental illness? Well, there's a short answer and a long answer. The short answer is that mental illness is any problem with your emotions, behaviour or thinking that affects the way you function to a degree that worries you. Or, as the Australian Department of Health defines it, a mental illness is a health problem that significantly affects how a person feels, thinks, behaves and interacts with other people. If that's enough for you, skip the rest of this chapter and have a cuppa instead. If not, listen on. The long definition of mental illness and definitions of all the disorders that fall under its umbrella is provided in large classification manuals, the most popular being the DSM, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. Remember that name, you'll hear it often in the field of mental health. Classification manuals get updated pretty regularly, and there's always much debate around them. It's worthwhile knowing a little about how definitions and classifications work. as they are the foundations upon which diagnosis and treatment lies. Definitions in healthcare determine who gets help, who gets paid, how much, and who gets all the benefits of sickness, such as time off work and sympathy. They also tell governments where to spend their health dollars. If you understand how these definitions work, psychiatry will make a lot more sense. Diagnosis. Diagnosis can set you free. It can be liberating. It can provide clarity. It can be a relief, an aha moment, not just for you, but everyone around you too. I discovered I was dyslexic when I was 38. It was a missing part of my puzzle. Finding out I was dyslexic was a triumph for the 8-year-old who was constantly told she wasn't trying hard enough to learn her times table or how to remember how to spell. But there's a downside to diagnosis too. It can be limiting. Having a label can make others prejudiced towards you. They may treat you unfairly or discriminate against you. It can also lower your expectations of yourself if you take it as an excuse not to live up to your full potential. People with disabilities carry the soft burden of low expectations. Graeme Innes, Australia's Disability Discrimination Commissioner, 2005 to 2014. Finally, when diagnosis is used in an accusatory fashion, it can be used to stereotype people. For instance, someone might say, "You don't want to travel with someone who is bipolar, they'll be unreliable and unpredictable." However, in most cases, diagnosis is beneficial overall. It offers the potential for insight into your situation and helps you and the people around you have realistic expectations. Classification. There are two main texts used to classify mental illness, the DSM, as mentioned above, and the ICD, International Statistical Classification of Diseases and Related Health Problems. The ICD classifies every illness and only has one chapter on mental illness. The DSM is just about mental illness. Both are used by mental health clinicians, but the DSM is more popular. Both manuals are mind-numbingly dull to read, but they are often referred to as medical Bibles, simply because everything in healthcare starts with them. The definitions of mental illnesses in these classification manuals determine what the health industry thinks should be treated. By implication, they say, these are illnesses and you should get help for them. With physical problems, for example, a broken arm, it's pretty obvious something is wrong. Everyone will agree you should go to the doctor and have it treated. But when your problem is something that is harder to see, like anxiety, do you go to a doctor or do you seek help elsewhere first? Health professionals take these definitions and design treatments for the various conditions. They are saying, if you have this mental illness, say anxiety, as defined by this definition in this manual, this treatment should ensure you improve by a significant degree in a reasonable time frame. Governments and the insurance industry use the manuals to assign payments and determine what treatments they will cover officially. They say, if you have anxiety as defined by this definition in this manual, you're entitled to a certain amount of treatment under the public health system in your country. This means that people with vested interests can use classification to push agendas. For example, the private health industry and drug companies love broad and inclusive definitions because they mean more people get diagnosed and they make more money. Disease mongering has become a serious concern. But there are also many skilled, brilliant, and passionate healthcare professionals who push for broad definitions so more people get help. On the other hand, organisations that pay for healthcare, like insurers, often argue for narrower and stricter definitions to limit costs. It is not a perfect system, but the reality is that definitions set the agenda for what gets treated and what gets funded. What counts as mental illness? In psychiatry, we mostly use the term disorder rather than illness or disease. The term illness is too vague. No one agrees on what it means. And disease implies that there is some underlying pathology, a disruption in the structure or function of the body. Since we don't really know why we have mental illness, and since for most problems no pathology has been clearly found, we avoid using the word disease. No matter how you define mental illness, there are two key problems. How do we define normal behaviour, and how bad does a problem need to be called a disorder? Everyone has their own sense of what's normal. There is no universal yardstick. We are all crazy in our own way. We view life through a lens that has been constructed from our own past experiences. This includes our personality, our culture, our beliefs, especially religious beliefs, and the era we live in. Until 1973, the DSM included homosexuality as a disorder. This was a judgment. Society regarded homosexuality as abnormal. Multiple things happened to change this view. Gay activists began protesting. More and more people came out of the closet, suggesting homosexuality wasn't as unusual as initially thought. Research backed this up. In 1973, homosexuality was officially removed from the DSM. Treatments like conversion therapies are now more or less extinct in medicine, although some religious groups still think it's possible to pray away the gay. Hoarding disorder, on the other hand, is a recent addition to the DSM. Hoarding went from being an insult to becoming a formal diagnosis. People who have a conscious, ongoing urge to accumulate possessions, as well as corresponding feelings of anxiety whenever those possessions get thrown away, can now be diagnosed and treated. Until 2013, when the latest edition of the DSM came out, hoarding was an experimental category for further research. Times change, diagnoses change. One of the most recent disorders to be included in the DSM is gambling disorder. That doesn't mean that everyone who gambles has a disorder. In order to be diagnosed with it, someone must have at least four key symptoms of persistent and recurrent gambling behaviour associated with impairment or distress over a period of at least 12 months. With symptoms we all experience at some stage in our lives, such as sadness or anxiety, the problem becomes one of degrees. How much is too much? These are human experiences and they all occur on a continuum. There is no clear cutoff between a normal amount and an abnormal amount of worry or sadness, and there never will be. Psychiatry often gets criticised for being vague and subjective, but the problem of defining normality exists for all health issues. When does high blood pressure get defined as hypertension? When does a fast-growing cell get defined as cancer? At what blood sugar level should diabetes be diagnosed? To get around the problem of normal versus abnormal in psychiatry, a few steps are employed. First, we take a group of symptoms that seem to cluster together to form a syndrome. For example, in depression, we have lowered mood, lack of enjoyment in everyday activities, weight loss, altered sleep, agitation, fatigue, guilty ruminations, poor concentration, and suicidal thoughts. Then we set a cutoff point. For depression, we say you must have five of the listed nine symptoms. Then we refer to a minimum time frame. For depression, it's a minimum of 2 weeks of these symptoms. Finally, we say the symptoms must either cause significant distress or impair the person's function in some way. For example, interfere with their work, relationships, or education. Symptoms plus a time frame plus distress or impairment equals a disorder. But there is wriggle room. In clinical practice, the disorders are not meant to be used rigidly. If someone is assessed as being on the edge of a disorder, clinical judgment is required. There are many occasions in clinical practice where a person's problems don't fit snugly into a category, and judgment and experience are required to make a diagnosis and form a treatment plan. Classification systems provide a basis, but are not sophisticated or flexible enough to take in all aspects of human experience. Categories of disorders. In the current version of the DSM, it's up to the fifth edition, DSM-5, lists 20 major categories of psychiatric disorders and about 300 separate disorders. The major categories are neurodevelopmental disorders such as intellectual disability, autism, and learning disorders, schizophrenia and psychotic disorders, bipolar disorders, depressive disorders, including seasonal affective disorder and grief, anxiety disorders, including panic disorders.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.